Hey boys. Hey, my name's Simon Crafer and we're in the Olin's truck for this week's Tech Talk because it's about rear shocks. And it's a overview of rear shocks. We won't get too technical because we'll be here for hours. But to give you an idea, what are the important things about a rear shock or why do we even need one? Imagine if there was no control at all on that spring, you'd just be like pogoing around the track, you know, boing, boing, boing. And the aim of a rear shock is to keep the rear tire on the ground with contact as much of the lap as possible. Because without rear tire contact, you don't have grip. And everyone is chasing grip, right? So to give you a couple of little ideas, for example, in the slower corners, you know, getting across little ripples, bumps, or even a bit of broken asphalt, all the way up to in the middle of the back straight where there's a little bump, you're trying to keep that wheel on the ground, you know, so not get bounced off, it spins for too long, hits the ground, wears the tire more, and less drive forward. So imagine everyone's pushed on their motorcycle, you know, give it a bit of a push, and what you're feeling there is the low speed damping. And I remember getting told like it's like only testing your car in first gear, you know, when you've got five or six, because all we can feel is the low speed. And to explain about the low speed, all it is oil getting pushed through a hole and getting restricted by a needle. So the more you close those clickers, the more the needle goes into the hole, closes it off. The more you open it up, the more the oil flows. But that's the low speed. So when the piston's moving up slowly, pushing the oil, you know, so you've opened the throttle, the rear, it transfers to the back. That's the control the low speed has. And once it gets above a certain amount, a certain flow, you know, like for example, you hit a larger bump at higher speed and the piston goes, it gets too much flow for that little hole. And say this is the piston that gets pushed up and we've got a shim, one shim on both sides to seal it. And once that flow gets too much for that little hole, then it'll get to enough pressure to blow the shim off. That's the compression stack sealing shim. It'll go blow it off. And same on the way down, exactly same. A needle in a hole with it going on the rebound. And once it gets to a certain speed going down, it blows the sealing shim off the top, you know? And yeah, let's go on to that sealing shim. Then there's a whole lot of other shims behind them on the compression and the rebound that the technicians can play with to change the shape of the damping. And Mike Watt, we've got here, has kindly volunteered to build a typical shim stack setting up for us. Please show us how it's done, Mike. And I'll just talk through what we're going to do, what Mike's doing. So that initial, go to a builder up, Mike. That initial shim that goes on there, you can change thickness and diameter. And that initial one has a big effect because it's supporting like a leaf spring style setting of shims that get bigger and bigger. And obviously if you change the very first shim, it makes a massive difference, meaning one bigger and 1 millimeter bigger in diameter or smaller. Or width, it makes a huge difference on the setting. Then all of the other shims that he's putting on there, you can change the way they go on, meaning you can have a say a 0.2 thickness shim, or you can have 2.1s, which add up to the same thickness, but have a totally different feel and setting. And there's literally millions of different ways you can build these shim stacks up that all have different feelings, so it's seriously confusing. And once Mike has put on the compression stack, then the piston goes on, and obviously that last shim, the shim that goes against the piston, has to be a certain diameter because it covers the holes in the piston. It's a sealing one, but you can also change the thickness on that. So now the rebound damping stack is going on, and once that's on, so literally you can change both. Once that stack's on, sorry to rush your mic, he doesn't have time to measure it up. So then this all the main nut goes on there. It's much like an engine. It's got a big seal like a piston ring, and that goes in the shock, which is much like a cylinder. And that's it. And we've spoken about the top out spring in earlier settings, but we're not talking about springs today. But yeah, that's all built up. And once that goes together, I'm just going to explain what happens. Normally we put oil in here. We're not going to do that because we want to, normally Mike puts oil in and then we put it together. Then that oil from this side of the piston all the way through the clickers where the compression is, runs through to a tank here. And there's a piston that floats here in that tank. That side is the oil, you know, so when the shock goes in, the shock shaft displaces more oil, pushes that piston, it floats, and you have gas pressure this side, no bubbles of air, really sealed well in there, gas pressure on this side to keep it more compressed, and so it doesn't cavitate and get air and be like a milkshake and you have less control over it. So let's, so oil, then gas on this side, piston there. Let's now, can you imagine how many settings there is? Like millions, like I said. Well, instead of a rider having to test each one, which is obviously crazy expensive, what the Olin's boys can do is run the shock on a dyno, and they can make little, like one setting change, like one shim thickness change, anything they want. And once this dyno, it builds up, basically it runs at different speeds, as you can see there, really low speed. It slowly builds up and records exactly the amount of damping that shock has at all different speeds. And we're not going to wait around until it's, well, we might look back in a moment when it's going really high speed. So it's recording now what the shock does. It'll slowly build up speed, like I said. But if we come down here, we have printouts of different shim stacks on the same clicker settings here. So you can see right at the beginning is the low speed damping where the clickers work. And you can see how much you don't feel, you know. So in here is where your clickers work, low speed. Then over there it's the shims, and that's two different shim stacks. So earlier I mentioned how this piston is displaced by a shaft, and that is one model of shock, but many of the MotoGP shocks run this new, MotoGP teams run this new shock, which the shaft actually goes through and out the other side into air, so it's right through, and it doesn't displace any extra oil, which is why it only has a little tank on there, which that tank is solely for keeping the oil under pressure with a little bit of gas. It doesn't need to be so big. And it's much like the new model forks, those carbon forks that you see on the bikes, beautiful things. Really similar system, damping wise, and through shaft to the latest shocks. And here we go, we're just seeing it's building up the different speeds. So it slowly goes higher and higher, so we can have different. Fantastic, eh? So imagine how much money in testing time and riders scratching their heads this machine saves. So what I'd like to finish on is by telling you, I mentioned front forks are really similar to that new style, you know, beautiful carbon fiber. But that's a whole new subject, you know, that it includes friction and flexibility, how big a tolerance is to get the right feel in front forks. But that's the subject for another day. Hope you enjoyed.